Hello, greetings. I'm back. There's an end card at the end of this video discussing this channel and me. Additionally, there will be spoilers for Breaking Bad within this video. I mean, that's self-explanatory, but just in case. All right, enjoy. No! No!
No! The death of Drew Sharp. In a show where murder and death isn't all too uncommon, it's pretty special that this one particular death is, by most accounts, the most jarring and most cruel and most awful. Today I'm going to be talking about exactly how Breaking Bad accomplishes this with essentially an entire series worth of setup. What struck me as very unique and different about this murder when compared to the rest of the series was at first because of how sudden it was.
Just so you know, this isn't personal.
In a lot of these suspenseful dramas that involve moral depravity or criminal behavior, sudden deaths can be a bit of an overused trope. Is that all you get for your money? And it seems such a waste of time. Take The Walking Dead does it all the time in order to shock people, and eventually that shock wears off and you can't really earn it back. What is unique about Breaking Bad is they often treat murder and death much like how a real person might, in the sense that a lot of it is really, really premeditated and a lot of options are mulled over prior to deciding that eliminating this person is the only solution.
353 Juan Thibault, apartment 6. Yeah.
Whereas in this scene, without hesitating or even having a passing thought about it, Todd comes to the conclusion that murder is the only solution. On the subject of Todd as a person, we can segue over to morality. Morality is brought up fairly frequently when concerning the killing of somebody within the show. Jesse is present around Walt for a majority of the show, and Jesse's main character trait that sets him aside from the other characters is that he has some level of morality, especially when concerning children.
Hey, look at me. You wait right here, okay? It's just part of the game. You wait right here and... Look, just don't go back inside. Alright? You stay right here, okay?
We can parallel the death of Drew Sharp with the death of Gail Bedeker.
Can I help you?
I have money. I got a lot of money.
When Jesse shoots Gail Bedeker, he's shooting somebody who he's never really met at all in any formal context. Despite this, Jesse is shown as being extremely over-distraught during the act of killing Gail Bedeker, and even sometime after, it's still something that follows him around and weighs on his psyche. Additionally, just touching upon my previous point for a little bit, the murder of Gail Bedeker was planned as a contingency should Walt get threatened. Juxtapose this with Todd's very sudden and random urge to kill Drew Sharp. Afterwards, Todd begins to retroactively justify the death. Now, contrast this with, of course, the rest of the show, in which most major deaths are handled with proactive justification and, of course, premeditation.
You're done? You want to know what that means? I will tell you what that means. That means exactly how it sounds, yo. All right, we are witnesses. We are loose ends. Right now, Tuco's thinking, yeah, hey, they cook good meth, but can I trust them?
No.
It is him or us. You understand? It is him or us!
Todd begins to double down on the idea that killing Drew Sharp was the right call and that he was actually looking out for everybody around him. There is not a single mention by Todd of the moral qualms or issues with killing a child. It's never brought up. In fact, the closest thing Todd does to being sad is begging to not be let out of this drug cabal that Walt has going. The involvement of children within the criminal world and consequently the death of children is something that's brought up many times throughout the show and often viewed by even the most detestable of criminals with much disdain. Gus Fring, who views murder in a very soulless and corporate way, is offended when Walt implies that Jesse thought he signed off on a child's murder.
Explain yourself.
For him, you intervene. Put us all at risk. Some contemptible junkie who couldn't keep the peace for 8 hours.
Maybe. Then again, maybe he thought it was you who gave the order.
Are you asking me if I ordered the murder of a child?
Hello. And welcome to the Los Pollos Hermanos family.
Now, this is coming from Gus Fring, who most of the time has a very calculated and patterned behavior. His humble and yet very presentable appearance, a very cheery and corporate smile, and of course his very overall cordial behavior are all pretty disingenuous. Gus's actual behavior comes off as fairly soulless most of the time. But even this guy. Is above killing children. Up until the death of Drew Sharp, the most heinous thing done to a child was probably when Walt had poisoned Brock. However, he had poisoned Brock with a non-lethal poison, and even that still got to Walt's psyche. And the thing about Walt, especially in the latter half of the show, is he tends to justify every morally gray action he does by saying that it's for the good of his family. So it very often seems like he's almost always clear of any mental or moral consequences that go along with his actions. So even Walt, who is over time designed to be fairly unsympathetic, has more of a moral compass than Todd. When it comes to Todd's character, there's a sort of vacancy associated with it. Sure, sometimes he comes off as a bit eager, maybe even slightly compassionate sometimes, or endearingly human, at least occasionally. It's actually this furtive human side of Todd that affirms to me that he is somebody with ASPD, or more specifically, a sociopath. Sociopaths, unlike psychopaths, do have some limited way of making emotional bonds with people. However, their disposition often makes it pretty difficult. As we can see with Lydia Quayle, Todd has some pretty rough times taking social cues and understanding that Lydia really just isn't that into him.
Doing
good.
First things. Hey, I like your shirt.
My blouse.
Nice, yeah, like a color. Mm-hmm. It's a nice color on it. It's kind of a, I don't know exactly what you call it. It's kind of a cornflower.
Sociopaths are often extremely aware of their actions and what they're doing, and will often try to justify it to others, even if it's something extremely outrageous that no normal person would ever find justifiable.
I didn't want to kill him. You gotta believe that. You know, at the end of the day, it was him or us, and I chose us. And I would do it again.
Todd also has traits of generalized ASPD, as in both sociopaths and psychopaths are known to experience these.
people with this mental disease are often known to make very crucial decisions on a whim without thinking about them at all. No! Their lives are often characterized by obsession with personal gain and acquiescence of financial power. This, in my eyes, correlates with Todd's extreme desire to be ingratiated with the criminal underworld. The fairly frequent manipulative behavior that he exudes onto others when he wants to accomplish something.
I'll take that, Jesse. Jesse, I'll take that. On the way home, I was gonna get us some pizza. A couple large pies. Maybe a six-pack of beer. Some ice-cold beer. Does that sound good? Because you earned it today. You definitely did.
And of course, his ability to show callous, remorseless, and even sadistic behaviors towards people that he dislikes or just people who have to be removed in order for him to accomplish his criminal goals. Most of the traits I just listed were established during his altercation with Drew Sharp and the aftermath of his altercation with Drew Sharp. Such a furtive thing was a massive leap in his character development, and defines him as one of the most unique characters in the show. Of course, the traits that don't align with when he shot Drew Sharp were later added on and fleshed him out just a bit more, but the brilliance of being able to create a scene in which one bullet is shot and completely defines a character is pretty special in and of itself, and it's one of the hundreds of things within this show that is there to appreciate.
You know, Uncle Jack says, life's what you make it.
Hello, welcome to the Boy Afraid end card. If you are not an avid watcher of my channel, or you really don't care about the current status of me or this channel, you can click off. Thank you very much for watching to this part. See you later, hopefully. As for everybody else, I am here. I am back. I'm currently making a really, really big video that's sort of becoming the Boy Afraid Duke Nukem, in the sense that's a really voluminous task, and it's taking a while. So what I'm going to do to tide you over is, of course, providing you the Todd Alquist video. And I'm going to be revisiting Hotline Miami with a 5-part series, at least that's the roadmap that I've written down and in theory should happen, of shorter videos that will overall work cohesively with each other to show the themes of copycat serial killer culture within Hotline Miami, serial kill culture within Hotline Miami, and the Western world. And it should, you know, be a pretty nice return for a lot of people who watch my channel or come from that video. So, that being said, I am back. Life got in the way for a hot minute there. So, I was gone. I had to move. I caught the funny disease. You guys know the one. And, you know, just overall a lot of things happened. Part of it is work ethic, and it is my creative output. It is very hard to come up with ideas every minute of the day and tell yourself, is it worth 20 hours of my life? Maybe. So, that being said, this video is shorter. I hope you guys enjoy it. Enjoyed it, past tense. And I hope you guys enjoy what I'm going to be providing. So, stay tuned for more. Have a good one.